Hello friends, from today we are going to learn Java. The syllabus that I have chosen for this learning is ICSE class 9th. They have a book on Java. So ICSE has Java in their syllabus from class 9th till class 12th. So we have Java with BlueJ. For those of us who are learning programming for the first time, for them BlueJ will be quite helpful. BlueJ is like the swimming pool of the Java programming. Instead of learning to swim in a river or in a pond, you prefer to learn in a swimming pool. So it's like a protected environment and it is easy to learn. So let us see how we can learn Java using BlueJ. You will have to install the BlueJ's software or the IDE on your computer. You will have to install the Java's JDK, the latest JDK. You can download it from Oracle's website and install it. And after installing the JDK, you can install the BlueJ software from BlueJ.org. After installing these two softwares, when you start the program, first click on Project and New Project, and then give that project a name. Let us say Project 1. A new window will appear. On that window, you will have to create a new class. The class name will be the one which you give inside your program. Here in our first program, we are going to give the name Hello World. Once you create the class, it will create an icon in the project window. You will have to double click on that icon. The editor will open. There is already a default program, a sample program installed in there. You will have to delete it. Press Ctrl A on your keyboard and select all the text in there and then delete it. And after that, you can start writing your program. So this is our very simple program. I will explain it to you. We start our program with the double forward slashes. This means it is a comment. The text after this double forward slash will not be included in the execution of the program. It will be treated as comments. So if you want to write a single line comment, you can use these double forward slashes. At the beginning of each line, you can use these double forward slashes. In case you need to write a multiple line comment or a comment block, you can use this notation. You can start by forward slash star and then start your comments. If you go to the next line, start with a star and then type your comment. And when you want to end the comment, type a star and a forward slash. Begin with a forward slash star and end with a star forward slash. And in between, you will type one star at the beginning of the line. So this is how you can use a comment block. Now let us start the program. Public class Hello World. Defined a class here. Public is called access specifier. Class is our keyword and hello world is the user given name. You can decide what name you want to give to this class. We will create a opening brace and there will be a corresponding closing brace. This is the beginning of the class block and this is the end of the class block. From opening brace to the closing brace. If you look at a Java program, you usually will find indentation. After one line, you will find the next line is indented. The indented is done so that you can recognize these blocks easily. Inside a class block, there is a function block. Every Java program should have one main function. So this is the function block. We will declare the function here. Public static void main in bracket string args. There is a square bracket, opening and closing bracket, a pair of brackets, string args, bracket close. Then there will be opening curly brace and a closing curly brace. we will write only one executable statement in this function block, system.out.print in bracket in double quotes hello BlueJ, bracket close and a semicolon. Now if you look at all these different keywords and other access specifier and other words, there are only two words that start with a capital. String starts with a capital, the S in the string and S in the system. Only these two things are in capital and all of them are, all of others are in small letters except the user given name. In user given name you can decide any number of capital or small words that you want. And then after an executable statement there is a semicolon. See, there is no semicolon here or here. It is only inside a function block and only for the executable statements there will be a semicolon. After the function is closed, for closing the function you will use a closing brace and then we will close the class from here. So this is a simple program. You can type this program inside the opened text editor of the BlueJ. If you want, I can paste a copy of this program in the comments box under this video. You can simply copy it from the comments box and paste it. After pasting this program, you need to first save it, and after saving the program, you need to compile it. There is a button called compile, press on it. After compilation is successful, you will see such message at the bottom of the screen. After the compilation is successful, you close the editor's window and then you will see the icon of the class Hello World. You will need to right click on that icon. You will see void main string args. You will see this function in the menu. You need to click on it. That will open another window. All that we need to do in the another dialog box is just press OK. And then there will be a small output window popped up, maybe at the left, top left corner of the screen. If it is minimized, you need to drag and bring it in the center and then enlarge it a little bit so that you can see the text inside it clearly. You will find our output Hello BlueJ or whatever you want to write in the output. So this is how we create a new project and then create a new class and then type your program inside that class. After that you save it and compile it and then you need to run the program. So this is how we learn programming in BlueJ. Now let us look at a little bit longer program in Java. So let us look at another Java program. To run this Java program, you need to create a new project inside the BlueJ's integrated development environment. First, create a new project in BlueJ. After creating a new project, create a new class in the project window. We'll give a particular name to this class. We have used a name called taste_fruits. T is capital, taste_fruits, that is the name of our class where the main function is located. And we have created three additional classes and we have created objects using these classes. So let us see how it is done. Java is called a object oriented program, isn't it? OOPS is object oriented programming structure. So let's see a little bit of the OOPS in action here. We'll create three simple classes: class mango, class apple and class grapes. These are the three names of classes. And each class we are creating a function called taste. The name of the function is same in these three classes. Then how are we going to differentiate between one function from other? Because whenever we are calling a function, we need to specify the object of that particular class. So each class will have its own object and that object will call the function from that class only. So even if the names of these functions are same, they belong to different classes. Inside the test function, we are simply printing one line. There are actually longer lines. I will also paste a copy of this program in the comments box under this video. you can copy it and paste in the newly created class in BlueJ and then save it, compile it and run it. So let us see how this program is done. After creating three classes, we are starting with our public class test fruits. The class begins from here. Public static void main string args. We are going to create an object of type mango. The first statement here is mango m. This is a variable declaration. If you have already learned any other programming language, then you must be familiar with the concept of a variable declaration. Suppose we want to use a integer to be stored inside a variable, then we need to create a variable of the type integer. If you need to store characters, then we need to create a variable of the type character. So we need to have a variable of that type of primitive data type. Each data type, the type of the variable has to be declared. But here it is a bit strange. We have declared a variable called mango. It means mango is a data type here. So in Java, we have a special data type. Mango is actually name of a class. Here you can see it is a class, but we are mentioning the class as a data type. It is a very special data type. It is called reference data type. It is called a reference data type. Mango M, the variable will be declared as a variable of the class mango. Then what we will do? We will store a new instance of this class, a reference of the new instance of this class inside this variable. So there is a keyword called new. When you write new mango and two brackets, it becomes a default constructor. Mango and two brackets, it will create a new instance of the class mango, and then the reference of this new class will be stored in the variable m. So that makes our m as a new object. For the sake of convenience, we call m as a object of the class mango. So there are two ways to create an object. You can use these two lines, or you can make it in a single line. Apple A is equal to new apple, grapes G is equal to new grapes. So that will make us three objects, M, A and G. These are three objects of these three classes. What does this object do? It can call the function mentioned inside that class. M can access the function inside the class mango. So if you write m.test, it will call the function test from the class mango. A.test, this will call the function test from the class apple. G.test, it will call the function test from the class grapes. And then whatever is the output of these two, three classes will be displayed in the output screen. So copy and paste this program and then compile it and run it. So for running the program, you need to right click on the icon of the class and then select void main string args, and in the new dialog box press OK. That will display the output window. So this is how we create classes and objects in Java. This is the third chapter called Values and Data Types. Now let us see what is the scope of this syllabus. We are going to learn character sets, then Unicode and ASCII. What is Unicode and what is ASCII? Then what are the escape sequences in Java? What is called a token in Java? What are the different types of tokens? What are identifiers or variables? What are the different types of data types in Java? And how the type conversion is done? So these are the points we are going to learn in this chapter. Now let us see what is the character set that can be used in Java programming. Which are the characters? The character sets. We can use letters, digits, operators and punctuation marks, which is also called delimiters. As we use English language in India, so we can use all the characters of the English language, which comes from the Latin characters. So these are the letters, capital A to capital Z, small a to small z, all the 26 alphabets. Then we can use the digits 0 till 9. These are the basic digits. We can use all of them. And then there are operators, arithmetic operators, logical operators, relational operators, and punctuation marks. So these are the arithmetic operators. You can find them all on the keyboard. Plus, minus, asterisk, forward slash, and percent. This is the addition operator, this is subtraction operator, this is multiplication operator. We use asterisk as the multiplication operator. We use the forward slash as the division operator. And this is percent, this is the modulo operator. It gives us the remainder of the division of two digits. Then we have logical operators. This is AND. If you type AND two times, it becomes a logical operator and it is still called AND. These are the straight lines, these are standing lines. If you print the standing line two times, it becomes OR operator. This is the exclamation mark. It is used as a NOT operator. AND, OR and NOT, these are the logical operators. Relational operators, these operators are used to compare two values, whether one value is smaller or greater or equal to another variable. So this is smaller than or equal to, greater than or equal to, equals equals. If you type equals equals two times, this becomes a relational operator. This can be used to compare two values to find out whether they are equal or not. If you use the equals to operator for only one time, then it becomes an assignment operator. Then exclamation mark and equal to, this becomes a not equal to operator. Then let us see the punctuation marks or delimiters. We have a dash here, a semicolon, a colon, a question mark, a full stop, and these are round brackets. This is the opening bracket, this is the closing bracket. Then we have curly bracket or curly braces, opening brace, curly, closing brace. These are the square brackets, opening bracket, closing bracket. So we can use these punctuation marks. And all these letters, digits and operators can be found on your keyboard, on your computer's keyboard. So we can use all of them when we are typing a Java program. Now let us learn what is ASCII and what is Unicode. When the computer revolution began in Europe, most of the countries that were using computers had one thing in common. They were using the Latin character set. Most of the countries in Europe, even if their languages are different, such as English or Italian or French or German, but the characters that they use to write their language is the same. It is the Latin character set. ASCII contains the Latin characters. The same character set that we just saw is the ASCII character set. When we type anything from our keyboard into our computer, the keyboard can send the information of the character into the computer. But when we are programming, as you know, all the information in a computer is stored as binary digits, 0 or 1. So every symbol or every character has to have a unique code so that the computer can identify what are we trying to say or what are we trying to type. So every character has a binary code. So this coding is called ASCII character set, American Standard Code for Information Interchange. Here you can see an image of the ASCII character set. So for some time period, the ASCII character set was enough for English and other Latin-based European languages. But when other countries started to use computers, there was a need to accommodate other languages also, such as we use several languages in India which use different scripts. We use a Devanagari script. The Devanagari script is used in Sanskrit, Hindi, Marathi, Sindhi and Nepali languages. Apart from that, there are other character sets, such as there is Tamil or Urdu. These all have their own character sets. So to accommodate these and other character sets from other countries, the Unicode was created. Unicode has blocks for all the languages of the world, all the major languages of the world. So that is what Unicode is. Here you can see the Unicode block for Devanagari language that is used in Hindi and Marathi programming. So I think that is enough introduction for ASCII and Unicode. I will stop here. Let us see what are the escape sequences in Java. When we are typing on a text editor, if we want to go to a line after typing a few characters, then we press the enter key. If we want to indent it, we can press the tab key. This is how we format the text in a text editor. But when we want to format the text inside a Java program, that is in the output of a Java program, how we are going to do? Let us try to enter formatted text in the output of a Java program. Here I have created two lines to be displayed as the output of a Java program. But the compiler will immediately show me that there is some error and there is a red line at this spot of the error. If I take my mouse cursor at that position, it will show me what the error is. So the Java program integrated development environment does not accept a new line. We cannot pre-format the output of a Java program. So what we are going to do if we want to create a new line or tab, or if we want to create quotes or double quotes, for the sake of formatting, we need to give a special set of characters. These are called the escape sequences. So escape sequences are the formatting instructions inside the output of the Java program. Here are some of the commonly used escape sequences. Backward slash n is new line. Backward slash t for a tab, horizontal tab. Double backslash will print a backslash. That is useful when you want to type a path of a file as the output of the program. Now if we want to type quotes, then we need to enter backslash single quote or backslash double quote. Let us see these in action. When we are trying to produce output in a Java program, we use system.out.print as well as system.out.println. When we use the print command, it will print the text in the same line. So even if I type two lines as the output of the Java program and I use system.out.print commands, both these lines will be printed in the same line. Whereas if I use system.out.println, that is print line, it will print the output on the existing line and then move the cursor to the next line. So here is a small program with four lines of code, and let us compile and run the program and see how this functions. Now let us put other escape sequences in action. Here are a few lines I have created to show how the different escape sequences work. System.out.print. Both these lines appear System.out.print on a single line. System.out.println. Let us see some escape sequences. System.out.println / t horizontal tab. So we can enter our escape sequences inside the double quotes. The double quotes are mandatory whenever we are trying to create output in a Java program. And here we can create a / and a single quote and double quote. Now let us run this program and see how these escape sequences work. There is another escape sequence called form feed. It is / f. If you use this escape sequence, then the cursor will move to the next page. There are more escape sequences that you may need to use. If it is given in your textbook, you can read about it and try to test it in the Java's program, in the Java's compiler. So this is how we use different types of escape sequences to give formatting instructions inside the output in a Java program. Let us see what is a token in Java. If you have ever gone to a office to get your work done or to a bank, you may have noticed that if there is a queue, you get a token so that you can remember which number you have been allotted. Mostly this happens even in the clinics. If you go to a clinic, then you will get a token, and when your number comes, then you will be called. So that particular receipt is called a token. So token, a receipt can be called a token, or if you have a gift voucher or a gift hamper, that is also called a token. In English language, there are several different meanings of token. Token is used in literary terms in different ways. But in Java, we are going to see what a token is. The definition of token is, token is the smallest unit of code, smallest unit of code of Java, which the Java compiler can identify and process. So let us see a small example. A is equal to B plus C. Here A is a variable or an identifier. A, B and C, all three are variables. Equals to is the assignment operator. Plus is the addition operator. And semicolon is a punctuator. So these are all part of the character set of Java. Why are we calling it token? Because the classification here is made for the sake of the compiler. When you write a program, it will be compiled in a software called a compiler. So for the compiler to understand what is being sent into it, the classification is done. That classification is called tokens. Token is the smallest unit that the compiler can identify and process. So in the definition of token, there are different words. It is a smallest unit or it is a single element. Let us say we have a code of program, and in that code, A is an element, equals to is an element, B is an element, then token is a single element. Single element is a token. Or we can say smallest meaningful unit. Smallest meaningful unit which the compiler can understand. Tokens are nothing but Java's character set, the elements of Java character set for the sake of compiler. Let us see definition of token. Token is the smallest unit of code which the Java compiler can identify and process. So all the different tokens are nothing but the Java character set. There are literals or constants, there are identifiers or variables, there are assignments, punctuators, separators and keywords. Now let us see all these different types of tokens in detail. Now let us see what are the literals or constants as tokens. This is the classification of literals or constants. There are integer literals, real literals, character literals, string literals, boolean literals and a null literal. Integer literals are the integers. For example, 1, 9, 22, minus 35. They can be positive or negative both. Real literals are those which use a decimal point in the number. For example, 22.5 minus 36.2. These are real literals. Then we see character literals. Character literals are written in single quotes. For example, single quote A, single quote B. You can use capital letters, small letters. Also, you can use numbers. Even if you write a number inside single quotes, that becomes a character literal. It is not treated as a number, but it is treated as a character literal. And you can also print special symbols if you use single quotes. So these are all called character literals. Then there are string literals. For writing string literals, we use double quotes. If I write BlueJ in double quote, it becomes a string literal. If I write year 2020 inside a double quote, it becomes a string literal. Then we have Boolean literals. There are only two Boolean literals, true and false. It is not written inside any quote. True and false are Boolean literals. Then we have null literals. Backslash zero. It is not O, it is zero. Backslash zero in single quotes is called a string terminator. So these are all tokens in Java. These are literals or constants. Now let us see what are the identifiers in Java. Identifiers are a token in Java. As we have seen, token is the smallest unit of a program or a code that a compiler can understand. So identifier is also a type of token in Java. What is an identifier? Identifier are the names that identify a class, a method, a variable or a label. Let us look at a small Java program here. Public class test, public static void main, string args, integer a is equal to 70. So we have tried small Java programs in the previous videos, so you know what this program is. Now let us see what are the identifiers in this program. Public class test. Test is the name of the class that the user has given. If you write a program, you will give this name at this location. So this is a class name. After that, there is a function or a method called main. Public static void main. Main is a method name. Now string args. String is a class name and args is a variable name. This we are learning for the first time. Integer a is equal to 70. Here a is a variable name. So we have a class, a method and a variable. So all these names are called identifiers. And these are the smallest units of a Java program. So these are also tokens. An identifier is a token. An identifier may constitute a class name, a method name, a variable name or a label. So how do you write an identifier when you want to write a class name? What are the things that you can do and you can't do? You can use all the alphanumerical characters such as capital A to capital Z, small a to small z, 0 to 9 and a dollar symbol and an underscore. So only do these two special characters you can use. You can start the name of, you can start an identifier with any alphabet. You can start it anything from A to Z, but you can't start it from a number. The name cannot begin with a number. The name has to start from one of the alphabets. Either it is capital or small, doesn't matter. You cannot have a space in the name. You cannot make a space consisting of two different words. It has to be a single word. So in case if you want to extend the name, you can use underscore. And the identifiers are case sensitive. It means if you use a capital or a small letter, it is recognized as such. You cannot interchange between capital and small. It means the name will be treated exactly as it is written. That is the case sensitive. Reserved words can't be used. What are the reserved words in this program? Public, class, public, static, void, all these are reserved words. So we can't use these reserved words as an identifier. You cannot say public, class, class. You can't say integer public is equal to 70. So public is a reserved word. So you can't use the reserved words. There is a list of reserved words that may be given in your book. You can look at a list of them. Those reserved words can't be used as identifiers. So the main type of identifier we are going to see now is variables. This is the variable. So we will study more about the variables. Now let us see what is a variable in Java and what are the different types of variables and how they are declared and initialized. So a is equal to 0 if you want to write. A is a variable that you need to first create and then assign a value of 10 to the variable. Variable is a named memory location. Whenever you want to store any value in Java, you need to have some space. So that space is created using the variable. Variable creates a space in the memory and variable itself has a name. So you can access that space inside the memory. So variable contains a value and variables need to be declared and initialized. So you have to specify what is the data type for which you need that variable. So these are the data types for which you can create variables. It could be integer, float, double, it could be a character, it could be a string, or it could be boolean. So if you want to store an integer inside a variable, how will you declare it? You will write int a. So int is a keyword. Int a, that is the declaration that we need to create a variable called a of the type integer. Float f, we will create a variable f of the type float. Double d, char character, char c, string s, boolean t. So this a, f, d, it could be any name. You can choose the name you want. So this is the declaration. After declaring a variable, you can store data inside it. So there are two different ways of storing data inside a variable. First is called static initialization and other is called dynamic initialization. First, let us see static initialization. It means we will give the value at the time of declaration. As soon as we declare a variable, we will assign the value to it. First, we will create a variable of the type integer and then we will assign it a value. A is equal to 10. Equals to is the assignment operator. This operator assigns a value to a variable. So you can write it in two lines or you can combine it into a single line. That is also permissible. So we will write int a is equal to 10. So you can join these two lines. These are the two different lines in Java program. You can put it into a single line. So now let us see how a float variable is declared. Float f, f is equal to 10.5. Alternately, float f is equal to 10.5. Double d, d is equal to 0.0. Double is a float but having a double the space of the float value. So you can also write double d equal to 0.0 or whatever value it is. Character c equals to in single quote a. This is how you write the value of a character. You need to use a single quote if you want to type a character and store it in a variable. You can alternately write char c equals to single quote a. Now you need to store string. String is the data type, s is the variable name, and then you will initialize it. S equals to in double quote. String will be initialized using a double quote. Alternately, you can write string s equals to in double quote. Now the boolean data type, boolean t equals to false. Alternately, you can write boolean t equals to false. So this is the static initialization. You will declare and initialize at the same time. Now what is a dynamic initialization? Sometimes we will simply create that variable or a number of variables, and we will assign values to those variables during the execution of the program. Sometimes it could be user input. You can ask the user to input data and you can store it inside that variable. So that is called a dynamic initialization. So first you can declare it. You can declare several variables at the same time. You can use a comma to separate the variable names. Int a comma b comma c. Now c equals to a plus b. This will appear during the course of the program. When you will get values for a, b, c, then you can create a addition on these variables to add. Float a equals to 2.5 comma b equals to 3.5 and c. We have declared variables, and then we can call them during the course of program. C equals to a plus b. So for the double data type, you can declare it int a equals and double d. You can declare two variables. One is an integer, another is a double. Now you can use d equals to math dot sqrt square root of a. So it will calculate the square root of a, that is 25, and store that value in the variable called d. So generally dynamic initialization is done during the course of the program. Initially you need to just declare whatever data type you want for the variables, and then during the course of the time you can use those variable names inside your program to store whatever data you want to, whether it is generated inside your program or it is accepted from the user. Now here we declare three variables of the type string, string s1, s2, s3, and then we will assign values to these variables during the course of the program, and then we can manipulate them this way: s3 equals to s1 plus s2. So you can concatenate these two strings to produce a single string. So this will come later in the course of the program. So this is how the dynamic initialization can be applied to the variables. We are studying tokens in Java. Now let us look at some other tokens in Java: punctuators, separators, operators, and keywords. Now let us look at punctuators or punctuation signs. We mainly use three punctuation signs: question mark, a dot, and a semicolon. Where do we use the question mark? We use the question mark inside a ternary operator. For example, max equal to in bracket a is greater than b, question mark a colon b. The ternary operation works. We evaluate the left side of this question mark, and if this turns out to be true, then max equal to a. If a is greater than b, if it is true, then max equal to a. If it is false, then max equal to b. So this is how we use the ternary operator. So this is how we use the question marks inside the ternary operator. Then let us look at the dot punctuator. Dot is a punctuation sign or punctuator. We use dot in system dot out dot print or dot println. So we are combining system out and print with a dot. Why do we do that? Because Print is a function or a method which is related to the object called out, and this object is part of the class system. So these are all three connected. So in order to connect the related class, object and functions, we use a dot. So this represents the scope of a function. This function is part of this object. This object is a part of this class. Then semicolon. We use semicolon as a statement separator or a statement terminator. When the Java program begins, we import some Java packages. So here is a statement: import java.io.star. This is an import statement. So we will use a semicolon after the end of the import statement. Then also we use semicolon inside a block of code. So this is a block of code. Int abc is a statement. We will end this statement with a semicolon. Then we will begin another statement, a equal to 5. So whenever the compiler comes across a semicolon, it will treat the previous part as a single statement. And after the semicolon, whatever comes, it will treat it as a separate statement. So you can write these statements in separate lines, or you can put all of them together in the single line. That is also possible. If you write all these four lines as a single line, but still if you terminate each statement with a semicolon, that is also syntactically correct. So these are the punctuators, which are the tokens in Java. Now let us look at the separators in Java. There are four types of separators here: a comma, brackets, curly brackets and square brackets. Comma can be used to separate variables, for example integer a comma b comma c. So whenever a comma is given, the compiler understands that one variable is different from the other variable. So the comma is for the compiler to understand, because comma is a token and token is the smallest unit of the code that the compiler can understand. So whatever we are studying as tokens is for the convenience of the compiler. That is how the compiler detects and interprets these tokens. Now let us see the normal round brackets. In the first Java program, we can find all the three brackets here: public static void main in round brackets, string, square brackets args, and curly brackets. So here main is a method, and within the round brackets, whatever is written is called the argument of this method. These are the arguments. So you can use these brackets for writing arguments of methods. If you have written mathematical formula, if you want to prioritize some operation, then you use these brackets. So within the bracket, whatever mathematical equation is given, that will be evaluated first. So to specify the priority of operation, you can use these brackets in Java also. Also in loop control structure, for example, if you are writing a for loop, you will use these brackets to mention the control structure. After that, you see the curly braces. You have seen curly braces. Whenever you write a class, after writing the name of the class, declaring the class, you begin the code by a opening curly brace, and then you end the class with a closing curly brace. And within that class, if you write any method, and the code within that method, the code block, the code for the method is also begins and ends with a curly brace. So curly brackets define the block of the code for that particular function or method or the class. So we usually indent the coding so that we can understand the blocks easily. Now let us look at the square brackets. we can use square brackets to declare a array and then initialize a array and also access the array elements. So here string array cars. So we have declared an array of the string data type and we have named it as cars. After that we will initialize it, we will add values to it. String cars is equal to the whole, this part will go within curly brackets and the values will go inside double quotes because it is a string. Strings are enclosed in double quotes and they are separated by commas. So we can use the commas to separate values also, not just variables, but also text strings also we can separate using the commas this way. So how are these elements numbered? The numbering begins with 0. This is the 0th number. This is the first, this is second. So if you want to print the first or the 0 numbered element inside a string, we will use system.out.println in brackets cars and square bracket 0. Cars is our array. Cars is our string array which contains these values. And if we write cars in square bracket 0, it will access the first, that is the 0 numbered element of the string array. So this is how we use different types of brackets. So these are all called separators in Java. Now let us see operators and keywords in Java. Operators are arithmetic, relational and logical. Three types of operators are there. Arithmetic operators are plus, minus, division operator, multiplication operator, etc. Relational operators, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, equal, equal, this is the comparison operator, and not equals. Logical operators, and, or, not. And the keywords or the reserved words. You may have a list of these words in your book. You can see a full list of them inside in your book. So few of these keywords are public, class, for, else, float, etc. So all these things are tokens. So when you use the word public, the word public has a special meaning for the Java compiler. It is a token in Java. So you cannot use this word as a variable name or as a identifier name. You cannot use to name anything else. So these are to be used for the purpose they are created. Now let us look at the last portion of the third chapter, the data types. So whenever you are writing a program and if you initialize, if you declare a variable, say for example int a comma b comma c, so these variables are declared to be of the type int. Int is the data type. Then these variables will go to the compiler and compiler will reserve space in memory 4 bytes for each variable. So that is called a storage assignment phase in the compiler. So compiler has to know what is the data type of your variable to reserve space in the memory. So in the storage assignment phase, the compiler allocates memory for variables according to the data type. Therefore, we have to know what are the different data types in Java. There are two main classifications, two main types, primitive and non-primitive. Primitive data types are those who does not depend on other data types. That is the definition of the primitive data type. There are two categories of primitive data types, numeric and non-numeric. Numeric data types are those where we store numbers. That is the numeric. There are two types of numbers, integer numbers and floating numbers. Integers are the whole numbers and floating numbers are those which contain a decimal point, that is called a floating number. And then there are non-numeric data that does not contain numbers, that is called non-numeric. There are two types of non-numeric primitive data types, characters and Boolean. So now let us see what are the integer types. There are four of them. They are categorized according to the size that we reserve, the smallest first and the longer ones later on. So byte data types, the compiler reserves 1 byte for a byte data type. For short, you reserve 2 bytes. For int, you reserve 4 bytes. For a long data type, the compiler reserves 8 bytes. For a float number, the compiler reserves 4 bytes. For a double number, the compiler reserves 8 bytes. Now for characters, we need to store only one character in a character variable. Therefore, the compiler reserves only 1 bit of memory space. For a Boolean variable, the compiler reserves 2 bytes. So these are the primitive data types. Now let us look at the non-primitive data types. Whenever we are trying to create an object from a class in Java, the class is considered as a data type, that is called a reference data type. So here class is a non-primitive data type or a reference data type. Classes, arrays and interfaces are 3 reference data types in Java. They don't have a fixed value of memory to be reserved. When you write the program, at that time according to the requirement, the memory allocation will be decided. So these are the different data types. Now let us look at the string data type. How do we create an variable of the type string? String st equals to, in double quotes, hello BlueJ. St is the name of the variable and hello BlueJ is its value. So there is a separate memory location in JVM's heap called string constant pool. The Java virtual machine has 2 different types of memory allocations or memory locations. One is called stack and another is called heap. So inside the memory area called heap, there is another memory area called string constant pool. So let us try to understand like this. Whenever we declare a string, Java creates a new string object. So the string variable st is declared inside stack. Then JVM creates a string object inside string constant pool. This square area is the new string object. This is the variable name, this is its value, and there is a pointer pointing to the variable and its value. This is the string object. String object is stored where? Inside the string constant pool. Where is string constant pool? It is inside heap. If you create another string variable, then one more object will be created inside string constant pool. So this is how the strings are stored, or the memory allocation for string is done in JVM, Java Virtual Machine. When you are writing a Java program, suppose there are different variables of these types. Suppose one of them is integer and another is long, and if you are trying to add them, what will happen? The value will be stored in a bigger variable, a bigger data type. That is called implicit type conversion. So here is an example. Int a, long b and long c. C is equal to a plus b. A is an integer, b is a long. If we add an integer and a long, the value has to be stored in a long variable or in a larger data type. That is called implicit type conversion. And what is an explicit type conversion? So suppose if you want to convert a float number into an integer or a double into an integer, that will be called a explicit type conversion. So we can mention that we want to convert from one type to another type. inside the numeric only. So suppose we declare two variables of type double x, y, and after adding these two variables x plus y, we will force it to convert into integer. So double will be converted to integer. Double is a larger data type, integer is a smaller data type. So we can do that also. From larger to smaller we can convert, and we will store inside another integer variable. So this is called a explicit type conversion.